you guys. So about 20 years ago, Dr. Atkins sought to change the way we thought about food. He wanted us to think about how we consumed it, what we put into our bodies, the frequency in which we consumed it. Essentially, he wanted us to change our mindset. And today, I want you to do the same thing. I want you to think differently about something that you do every day, about something that you consume every day, and let's start a new diet revolution. But this one is not a food diet. It is a digital diet, okay? Now, I wouldn't ask you to do anything that I haven't done myself, but last August, I decided to go on a digital diet, and I took the whole month, 30 days. I eliminated email, social media. Yes, I did. I kid you not, I did. And I had to take this stuff out of my life because, you know, they say when stuff isn't adding up, it's time to subtract. So that's what I did. I, you know what, and I really brought it on myself. After about 7 years of just being online all the time, I had maybe 12 hours straight, whether it was professional or personal. But it just got to a point where I kind of just had enough. I wasn't a fun person anymore. My skin started to break out. And I had all these stressors, and I just didn't know what it was. Last August, I had a laptop, a tablet, and 2 cell phones. And I even went down to that Swedish furniture store and bought a laptop stand so that I could scoop my computer up to the bed. I drove my husband nuts because the things would beep all night, and he's like, I cannot sleep. This stuff is beeping all night. But I was on this continuous quest to try to build my brand in the social space, and it just got to a point where it took over my life. So when I took that time to myself, I knew that it was just something that I needed to do, and it was a diet. It was like a fast and a cleanse at the same time, but I had to do it. It was just something that spoke to me very loudly, and I'll tell you, it's hard. You know, I had to leave 10,000 of my closest friends because at that time I had about 6,000 followers on Twitter, 3,000 some odd on LinkedIn, googobs of folks on Facebook. I had just gotten on Pinterest, so I don't even get me started on that one. But I just knew that it was something that I needed to do. And I was looking for inspiration because I needed to figure out, did anybody else feel the same way? Was anybody else doing this? And luckily, Baratunde Thurston, he's an author, an entrepreneur, and a comedian. And now this guy, it's really interesting. Back in like June or July, he wrote a piece for Fast Company called Unplugged. And when I read it, I was like, oh my gosh, I consumed it. Because this is a guy who wrote his autobiography in the cloud. He started one of the most popular political blogs. And I'm like, how can he leave the internet? Like, this dude is nuts. How did he do this? But that's what he did. He left the internet for about 25 days. And what I thought was interesting was his story when he did it. He did not set out for it to be a social experiment. He just did it because he was kind of tired. And when I read it, I was like, oh my goodness, I need to do this. This is something that I must, you know, I need to process this for my life. And maybe I was being a chicken by kind of just leaving and not dealing with my problems head on. But I knew that it was something that I needed to do. So as I read through his article, started taking notes. And I said, if I do this, how can I do it? How can I take the tools that he did or the things that he did and implement them in my life? And I took down my notes and then I picked a time. I said, what month could I pull this off in? Because I know I'm not going to leave the internet for 25 days, but what can I do? I said, I'll take email out and I'll take social media out and we'll start there. I couldn't leave the internet totally. I have a child who was starting second grade and we were going to be getting their grades online. But I knew that if I started there, that would be a good place for me. So what I want to share with you today is my story, how I did it, what I learned about myself and others, and then how I think it could help you. So one of the first things I did was, after I read his article, was I picked my month. And then I started the process to say, okay, now if I'm going to do this, what am I going to say to people, right? Because I'm the friend raiser, right? What am I going to say to people? But I started penning a note, And I sent an email to everyone that I frequently talked to at that point in time. And I kind of told them the story, and I just said, you know, I need a break, basically. So if you really, really need to talk to me and you have my number, you can call me. But everybody didn't have my number, so. So I sent everybody a note. And I was shocked because I got a lot of responses back from people that said, wow, this is awesome, and you must tell us about it when you get done. But I actually got one email back from someone who said, don't forget about that important thing you promised to do. And I thought, I'm leaving the internet. I'm not leaving life, right? So I was like, but that was exactly why I needed to leave. It was like, gosh, are you nuts? I'm not going anywhere. And then after I did that, I put that in the out of office. And then I started doing something else. I started unsubscribing to all of those e-newsletters that you get that you're like, why am I getting these things? So I started unsubscribing to those, and I put my inbox on mute. I let everybody on Facebook and Twitter know that I was leaving. And the last step was changing my profile picture. One of the tips I got for Baratunde was to put a kind of an out-of-office image up. So I wrote gone till September the 1st, and then I left. And I came, like, I think I went out of the room and was like, oh, my God, I did it, right? But at that point in time, I'd done something that I had not done in years. I immediately set boundaries in my life. And what I realized throughout this process was that I wasn't doing that anymore. I had just blurred the lines. People could reach me anywhere, anytime. It didn't matter. You know, if you didn't catch somebody on Twitter, then they're going to text you about it, right? And so at that point, I realized that I needed this digital diet because I needed to go back to the place of establishing boundaries in my life. So that was a plus for me. And in the process of establishing these boundaries, I realized that, again, I know I'm not the only person, so I had a lot of free time on my hands. So I started to look up some other, to see if anybody else is doing anything like this and how are they feeling. Because I tell you, after about 3 days in, I was like a crackhead. I was like, oh my God, I need the internet. I really was. And now I didn't give up Evernote. So I did pull out my phone and I was leaving notes to myself like, wow, this is how I feel today, you know. And I was like, I can't be the only person who feels this way, because I definitely felt like it was a bunch of crazy and then that downtime, just the first couple of days. So I found out about this concept here called digiphrenia. And Douglas Rushkoff, he's an author, and he talks in his book, it's a book called Present Shock. He talks about how, what digiphrenia is, a concept of us trying to live multiple lives at the same time. So living those dual lives at the same time. And the dual lives that he talks about is your online life and your real life. And he says that most folks are really kind of uncomfortable being in this space. And what I think is interesting about that is he's right, because let's just take today, for example. You've had hashtags up. You might be tweeting right now. But you really cannot be here and be there. You cannot, because you're going to miss something. You're either going to kind of chuckle to yourself because you read something in your feed, or you're going to miss something that some of the speakers have said today, because it really is an uncomfortable place to be in. And we don't really know that we have this uncomfortableness because, again, we haven't stepped away from it. And the other thing he talks about in digiphrenia, and I just thought this was hilarious, is that he says that time right now is really of no value. And what he meant by that is, let's put it like this. I'm old enough to remember a time that when you wanted to talk to somebody on the phone, you just had to call them at their house and hope they were there, right? And when we got called waiting, it was like, hello? Because I had my sister's 2 years older than me, my brother's 2 years younger, so, you know, we were fighting over the phone. So what I said that to say this. Time had value then. If someone said, I'll call you at 6 or 7, you knew that, oh, I got to get home by 6 or 7, right, so that you can get that call. But somebody could be texting you or calling you right now, and if you don't call them back in the next hour, they're going to lose their mind, right? Because time, again, time has no value when we're living in this space of the Internet of Things, where everything is connected. And so one of the biggest things I think I picked up during this digital diet was to reestablish what value meant for me and my time. And my time is very important. I have 2 young children and a husband, and why would I take time from them to give time to someplace else? And so that was huge for me. I tell you what, though, one of the other things that I think I picked up was Well, they say that the first step in recovery is admission. So I am here today to tell you that I am a functioning social media addict. But I let me tell you why I feel that way. A couple of things happened. One, because I knew I had to go cold turkey. I knew that there was no way I was not going to get on Twitter unless it was not on my cell phone. I just knew it. I said, I just have to take this app off altogether. It's not going to work. And so so that was the first step. The next one was that when I felt like I had to ask people's permission to leave, which again is nuts. When I sent that email after I sent it, I was like, why did I do that? Who gives a crap if I don't send somebody an email back? They did, obviously. So, you know, obviously I needed to do it. So the third reason why I knew I was addicted was because I allowed others to support my habit, right? Because I had all these Twitter followers, people would tweet me all the time and say, retweet my most awesome thing ever, you know, and I'm like, sure, you know, and I'm retweeting it, right? Because people knew that I had access to some things that they wanted access to, and so they were just supporting my habit. It got to a point where, it's funny because I was telling my husband, I was like, I cannot watch Scandal anymore because I'm on Twitter and I'm not paying attention. But that was a part of my addiction was, oh my God, I got to get on Twitter because we got to watch Scandal. No, I have to watch Scandal at my house, not on the computer. So the good thing about going on this digital diet was that I was able to admit that I had a problem, you know, and you may have one too. It's fine. You don't have to admit it now. You can do it later. But that was the great part about going through this process. I did pick up another addiction, I must tell you, but it was books. It was actual books. And I'd always been a voracious reader. Everybody in my house has their own bookcase, even my two-year-old. Everybody has their own bookcase, and we love books, right? And I could literally read them with the best of them. I'd churn them out. But what I found was that I would have concepts and I'd have quotes from books, but I could not attribute them to anybody. I couldn't remember where I'd read them from. I couldn't remember the greater concept that they belonged to. I couldn't bridge the gap. And what I found was that the reason why I couldn't do it was because I had these constant interruptions. I couldn't have, or I wasn't having a full thought, a fully realized thought from A to Z. And so getting into the books, you know, having that quiet time, I read about 7 books that month. I was super pleased with myself. But I remembered what I read, and that was the important part. The digital diet was that cleanse. It gave me an opportunity to kind of step back and say, okay, this is what this really means, and read paragraphs, not 140 characters. So I am very happy that I was able to break that addiction, pick up a new one. That's fine. I don't think I'll be back next year talking about my book problem, but I'm very pleased by that. And Hugh Kindler, yeah. So speaking of interruptions, I have some news for you guys. Parents, it's more fun to look at your kids in real life than it is to look at them on Facebook, okay? Seriously, I tell you, everybody who has kids, aunts, uncles, grandparents, whatever, nieces, kids are just adorable. And they're growing into people. Go figure, but they do interesting things. And I want to tell you 2 quick stories. I learned more about my kids and my husband during this time than, you know, like a lot of years put together. My oldest is 7. And I'll tell you, I found out that she has a verbal tic when she laughs. She goes, ha, 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 duh. And I just thought that was the cutest thing because I had not realized that she did that. I was so into other things, I had not even noticed that she had this verbal tic. And then around this time, in August, my son was starting to verbalize. And we would ask him, you know, about his classmates, and he would name them off, and he would say, Kennedy, Carter, you know. And then his teacher at the time, she's an older woman with a deep voice. I think maybe she smoked a lot through the years. But we'd say, and what's your teacher's name? And he'd say, Blondie. And I was like, my kid is a mimic. Like, I never knew that. He would pick the notes up, you know, when we were in the car, but the fact that he knew to say blondie, you know, I just thought that was the cutest thing. And that month, let me tell you, we went everywhere. We went all over the state. We went to museums. We went to zoos. We went to the aquarium. We had a ball. And we took a lot of pictures, and nobody saw them. So as I start to close, I think what I learned, especially with my children, is that I needed to be fully present in the moment. And I wasn't doing that, you know, being online. And so this diet gave me an opportunity to leave that stuff alone and do what was important. I learned a lot about myself. I mean, I was talking to one of the speakers and I was like, yeah, 30 days, do it. And they were like, what? And I was like, no, do it. Because you never know that you can until you try. And that's really cliche to say, but it was true. I would have never thought I was gonna do it. I know my husband didn't think I was gonna do it, but I certainly didn't think I did. But I even figured out other things about myself. I learned that I could drink my food. About a year prior to this, somebody gave me one of those little three-day cleanse, you know, little menu sheets, and I was like, not going to happen. I'm steak and potatoes. I am not drinking vegetables. That's not going to happen. But for some reason, I just kept the sheet. I just kept it, and then I pulled it out, and I said, I'm going to do this cleanse, and I did it, and it was gross, but I did it, but I felt good. I felt great after it. I really did. And then I also realized that I could sit still for longer than 5 minutes. Oprah and Deepak were doing this 21-day meditation online, and I was like, you know, in the zone. And that was another thing that I never thought I could do. I'd been doing yoga for many years and meditating for many years, but apparently I wasn't doing it right. So that was helpful for me. And just to get to a point where I could, you know, set boundaries, take my time back, have fully realized thoughts, be present. All of these things are important to me, but I think you're going to find they're probably important for you. You know, I don't know what you'll figure out, you know, if you decide to go on this digital diet. But what I do know is that when you're in the bottle, it's hard to read the label, right? So until you decide to take a break, you'll never figure it out. And I know what you're going to say. I can't get offline. All my friends and family are on Facebook. I'm going to miss out on something. But the thing is you're going to miss out on life if you stay there, right? And the poet Oscar Wilde said, we live in an age where unnecessary things become our only necessities. Is all of this really necessary? Namaste.